Whoa. This has to be the biggest house we've had yet. I think we actually had to turn a couple of people away. So welcome. Welcome to Saturday night at the Overlook. Tonight's film, Charlotte Sometimes, is a film that I saw last November at the Hawaii Film Festival, a wonderful festival that specializes in films of the Pacific Rim, which I always thought was neat until I realized that includes almost everything except Europe. South and North America, Asia and Africa, Australia, I mean, there's a lot around the Pacific. I went to see this film, and every once in a while you go to see a movie, out of maybe 400 movies I see in a year, that with its authority and its mood and its tone and its tension simply captures you, totally absorbs you. And that's what Charlotte sometimes did. It's a subtle film. It's a film that reveals itself as it goes along. I love films like that. Instead of setting out an agenda in the first act so that you can check off the stations as the train goes through them. This film begins with characters. The characters reveal themselves to us and to each other in a way that gradually becomes more and more complex and observant. The acting is perfectly suited to this approach. The actors are astonishing without exception in terms of making every moment seem like that moment, even though we later find out that other agendas may be involved. And the director's eye for where to place his camera, for how to handle lighting, for how to reveal and how to conceal, shows that Eric Byler is a natural-born movie maker. So, as usual, I won't go into detail about the film. In fact, I always feel as if the program goes into too much detail, so I recommend that you pick it up on your way out. It's always better. I mean, Gene Siskel was right. He wouldn't look at trailers. He would leave the theater. They were having the coming attractions. He wanted to know nothing about a movie before he saw it. I remember once we went to see Fargo and sat down in the theater, and we both thought it was a Western. And we didn't have any idea until the end that the Coen brothers had directed it. That was the way to see that movie. So after the film, we're going to be welcoming on stage Eric Byler, the director, Michael Idemoto, who is one of the stars, Jaqueline Kim, who is another one of the stars, and John Bard Manulis, who is the producer. It should be an interesting discussion because I was just interviewed by someone who said, all of these films seem to have a personal vision. And I thought about that because there are some movies that have a corporate vision or a generic vision. They could even be good ones, and that can be true of. And I said, yes, I believe that is true, and that tonight's film is even more personal than most. I think it comes out of deep feelings on the part of the author, and that we can talk to him about that, and that we can feel him. We can feel him, and we can identify with him. Thank you very much. Okay, hello. Hello. I'd like to present the director of the film, Eric Byler. Michael Idemoto. Jaqueline Kim. And the producer of the film, John Bard Manulis. I just want to say again what I said before the film about the control of the light in the film. This is a film where there's that one shot where we only really see your eyes when you open them. You're in the shadow on the right side of the screen. And it's so atmospheric, the balance of light. If you could maybe talk a little bit about that, Eric, about the plan of the lighting to keep everybody in and out of shadow in the night scenes anyway.
Well, a lot of the credit goes to Robert Humphreys, who shot it. He's shot, I guess every film he shot has been a bigger film than this one, and he had actually sworn that he'd never do it again at this budget level, or work with the line producer who asked him, and then he read the script and he said he was, he said, okay, I got to do one more like this, and I also give him a lot of credit for, it was my first feature and I was starting to become afraid right before we shot it, or actually not right before we shot it. As soon as I decided I had to shoot it on DV. I was afraid that the psychological nuances in this story wouldn't come through. And so I asked Robert in the week, leading up to production, should we shoot this like the Dogma 95 directors and have that sort of shaky camera that and the lighting that and the photography that never looks very good. Just create a sense of realism with the fact that we're using video. And he said, but look at these storyboards and look at the script that you've written. I mean, why change all of that, And so when the very first shot went up and came up and it's a shot where Michael pulls a note off the door and we actually used the first take and Robert Humphreys put the camera on a tripod and I knew that we'd made our decision because I wasn't going to fight with him on the very first shot of the very first day. And so we followed the pictures that I'd drawn to shoot this movie, and certainly shadows in terms of the way that we built the characters also made sense in terms of the way we shot it. And a lot of times I would annoy the cinematographer, and it wasn't always Robert Humphreys. Sometimes he wasn't available. We shot for 14 days, and I think four of them we didn't have Robert, and it was mostly me with a gaffer. So the gaffer would light it, and then I'd turn off two of the lights, and then we'd shoot.
You mentioned some of the psychological issues in the film, and I talked to you and to Jaqueline at... Michael, you weren't at Hawaii, no. But I talked to you two at Hawaii about it. But rather than give you leading questions, because I think I know a couple of the things you might say, I'd rather you all talked about the underlying feelings that, turn off that cell phone. The underlying feelings that generated the story. Whoever wants to start. Jaqueline, you want to start?
When Eric first told me about the film, he had described it in terms of my character, especially of imposters. People who sort of moved around the world, which I just don't think it's that different from how we are as human beings, with the person that you are in public, and then the person that you will reveal to the person that you hope to love that person. You will reveal that person. And I think that particularly my character is kind of incapable of exposing her heart. She's always sort of in a fiction, and she's a writer. And I think that being Asian American plays into that a lot. Being raised in a home where my parents didn't grow up telling their parents how they felt about things, so they never really asked me how I was feeling about things. They were very expressive when arguments would occur, and quickly they could hit the ceiling, these arguments. But often it was, probably unspoken, but somewhat encoded in us to just not express ourselves emotionally. And I think that that's sort of what's Asian American about the characters, even though we don't really talk about being Asian American. I think that's a thread that runs through the behavior or one's MO, so to speak.
Mike.
Well, I think when I first got to read the script, the good thing about it was that, you know, even though I'm completely lost with the reading the script, Eric took me aside a lot, and we met a lot about developing. Well, because most of, you know, we talked about a lot of, actually he talked to me about a lot of personal things where I could try to develop some of the silences, but a lot of it was him just telling me to be quiet and keep the wall up. You know, and,
Eric, to some degree, was Michael's character based on feelings that you had, or?
All of them, except for maybe Lori, come from me. There's a lot of me in Michael's character, and a lot of me in Jacqueline's character, and a lot of me in Matt's character.
Use the mic real close.
There's a lot of me in the biracial character, who a lot of times people ask me about him. Is that you? Because we're both half Asian. And I hope not, but it's funny, they never ask me, like, they'll say, are you Matt or are you Michael? And they never ask me if I might be Darcy, Charlotte. Those three, I definitely put a lot of myself into all three of them.
John, you've produced a lot of big pictures.
Comparably.
Well, I mean, big by any standard, I would say. But what attracted you to this project?
There was really two things, I think. One was a line that Michael Idemoto's character says, which is when they make their bargain and they say no more, no shortcuts. And I always thought that was kind of extraordinary, first in terms of insight, but also in terms of something for me that I've never really accomplished, and struck a very deep chord, and one that someday when I'm 70 or 80, I'll maybe solve. And I think also the universality of it. I mean, I was struck by so many things about this, and my family, my mother's family is from Chicago and is very much a WASP family, and very emotionally actually similar in a lot of ways to the emotions that are going on among these people. And I just found myself connected to that. And the other thing was, Eric's script was a really exemplar of visual storytelling, as the movie has turned out to be as well. And there have only been a few films that I've been involved with. Chinese film, The King of Masks, is one of them. But
we had this here. We had that here.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
Which is a fascinating experience, and I think Charlotte sometimes is the same thing, and I felt it in the script and when Eric was talking about it, which is that you could watch that movie without sound and understand that movie quite well, as a matter of fact, and I've done it in laboratory rooms and things. And that's very, very unusual, and it's very unusual in America.
I've just been listening to an audiobook of short stories by Ernest Hemingway, having read them all in college, but nevertheless, when you listen to them, you realize how the dialogue works. And this dialogue works in much the same way. There's a short story, for example, The Killers, in which nothing is ever said directly about anything. And I love the dialogue and the acting of the dialogue in terms of what is pushed out beyond the words or hidden behind the words. And you get up to a point where people are about to say something and they won't say it until the end, when you really let your feelings out in the last speech that you have. That's so unlike most films, in which if there's an issue, somebody will say, well, I think the issue here is, and then give you half a page of dialogue, which is always very boring because we're not listening to a speech. So if you could all talk about that a little bit.
Shut up, Michael.
Shut up!
Do you want to know why I set that the goal to be sort of subterranean and subtextual?
Yeah, there's a very definite style in this movie, yeah. Mm-hmm.
I just don't like to see the little man behind the curtain. I like to believe in Oz, you know? And when I watch somebody else's film and I find myself thinking about the director and not the characters, I care a lot less, you know, unless it's some I mean, unless there's some genius director or somebody, but I wasn't going to try to be that. So the movie couldn't be about the director, and it couldn't be about my genius ideas in my head that I would use any trick, no matter how silly, to get through to the audience. The voiceovers, the scenes where they sit across from a therapist who asks all the right questions, kind of stuff. I mean, I had some very complex ideas and ideas that I felt very passionately about, but I was just too embarrassed to kind of interject myself into the movie that was, for me, so much about characters that I believed in, that I believed were real people.
I feel like watching the movie for the upteenth time, I saw Darcy on the roof when she asks Michael if he's ever been to Canada. I think that's the furthest that the turtle's head comes out of the shell. And he just doesn't get it. I mean, he's looking at Laurie, and that's where his eye goes, but I think Darcy's so... she's so fragile, but I think what blocks her is she has these mental formations, in a way, of like what she thinks he's thinking about her or what she thinks he's saying. And it's definitely in the silences. And I think there's something in the silences that's really isolating, too. It's like sort of like you say something and there's a silence and you're like, okay, did that land? Will something come back? Okay, next time I speak, I'm not going to go as far. You know, it's that pregnant moment where something beautiful could happen if you'd have a little faith, but unfortunately you kind of shrimp up.
It's interesting that you mentioned Hemingway because...
Here's the mic.
Oh, sorry. It was interesting that you mentioned Hemingway because when I read the script, that was one of the kind of contrasts that I actually... you know, identified with in that sense where things are hidden and stuff. And I thought the dialogue was really cool because, you know, the fact that they held back a lot and stuff. But I also had like this a hopefulness that the green light in the movie was something, you know, on the way of the modern American writers like Fitzgerald's Great Gatsby or something. So I was telling Eric, oh yeah, yeah, yeah. You're a genius, man. You're using Fitzgerald. And he's like, no, that's just a green light next door, man. It just comes on. So I thought I was I had something going on at that time, but it didn't work.
Your character is so lonely. I love the presence that you bring in the opening shots before we ever know anything about you. You hear the noise from next door. You look out the window. You read. You go out. You come back. You work on the garage door. It's odd how completely I felt that I had a good idea of that character before I had any information, including your occupation. And you have the great line, you're a mechanic and you read. It's a good, but it's very well embodied, and it shows how dialogue is sometimes not even necessary to develop character. If the camera looks at an actor who is gifted and a director is gifted at seeing, then all of that can be there.
Yes, it's it's all him, so, you know, I just, thank you.
Although it made for a very interesting first read-through of the script.
Yeah. And your character, Jaqueline, I think there are moments when we feel that she is going to be very ominous or sinister in a more acting out way instead of in a more hidden way. In other words, we're thinking it's going to be a more conventional movie, and in another kind of movie, you know, you would pull out a knife and just kill him or something, you know. Or, you know, that the problem of bringing home the wrong date, and we've all seen those movies, but no, you're the person who really is hurt more than anyone else in this movie, I feel, is you. You hurt yourself, and you're going to keep on doing it, your character, of course. Be quiet, Jaqueline.
No, well, Eric had said that Darcy started with a major heartache somewhere. and never quite got over that, and is sort of preemptively striking people with a disguise, which is not wise behavior, is it?
For people or nations.
Yeah, for people or nations. But yeah, it's, she's got stuff going on.
You mentioned in Hawaii that there were what you felt were specifically Asian American gender issues in the film, which you doubted that would be obvious to every audience. You said something about that.
Yes.
Could you talk about that?
You know, I didn't really think about the audience very much in any of the artistic choices that I made. But what sort of inspired the beginning, and I have to go all the way back to there to talk about it, because I don't like to myself deconstruct the movie, but when I started, the way that I saw the world was I saw a lot of these couplings between Asian American men and Asian American women that were platonic, or that's what they called them. But there was always this tacit understanding that he would pretend not to love her and she would pretend not to know. And it's not necessarily an Asian American thing. I bet you everybody here has been in a situation like that. But there's a sort of a suspicion among Asian American men, I think, that somehow the choice as to whether this new person who comes into your life is going to be a lover or a friend is somehow contingent upon race. And, you know, I'm thinking about, you know, I was growing up south of the Mason-Dixon line on the East Coast, you know, before we moved to Hawaii. I looked a lot more Asian when I was young. And there's a certain sense of isolation when there's only two other specimens in this whole school. And of course, there's a little bit more isolation when you're not the same race as either one of your parents. So then your siblings, if you have them, are the only being that you know when you're a child that's like you. But, you know, as you start to come of age and you start to say, well, what kind of sexual being am I going to be? You look at the images that you see on television. And, you know, usually an Asian man is a technician and he's never a lover. And if he does express sexual desire, it's ugly or unwanted. So if you're an Asian boy growing up in this country and you're thinking, where do I fit, you know, as a sexual being, the message is the more you repress your sexual desire, the more you'll be able to be accepted or be able to fit in. And if you think about the messages that Asian girls get in this country, watching the images that we have on television and movies of Asian women, it seems as if sex is the only thing we want from them. The more sexy, the more beautiful you are, the more we want you. And so they sort of misinterpret, I guess, what we call exotification as acceptance. And so these two creatures, this Asian American boy and this Asian American girl, grow up, and he's a little bit more tied to traditional values, and not surprisingly, because the traditional values, whether they're Christian or they come from Buddhism or Shinto religions, or you know, those values are more in line with what, I guess, mainstream society wants from Asian men. And then Asian girls are so encouraged to be more sexual, and so they're sort of breaking through into another, you know, more, I guess, Western set of values, are more like Greek or, you know, the hedonistic sense of values that sort of have overcome Christian values here. And so these creatures don't know how to interact very well, and they sort of slide into this, they're attracted to each other, they want to be together, but they slide into this friendship thing, and I think there's a fundamental lie at the core of that friendship, and it often leads to some very difficult emotional situations.
And then another, it's funny because I feel like I know all the answers because we talk so much at Hawaii, but isn't it true that you were not made to feel welcome at certain Asian American film festivals because of your mixed race?
Well, I think as soon as they knew I was mixed race, everything was cool. It's just the confusion about that when it's just the name on a film.
One festival turned your film down, right?
Yeah, we get turned down from a few Asian American festivals to begin with, but as we started to win at the mainstream festivals, our stock with the Asian American community went up.
I remember the first Asian American independent film that I can remember seeing was Chan Is Missing, which by Wayne Wang, which was a good film, and it was set in Chinatown, of course, in San Francisco. And everybody was just amazed that this film had been made. And that was 20 years ago or so. I feel as if I have actually seen a whole cinema growing up in America, not only Asian Americans, but other minority groups too. It's no longer the official theory that every character in a movie has to be Caucasian. And yet, I talked recently to Justin Lin, who's Better Luck Tomorrow is playing around the country, about when he was auditioning actors. And one of his actors came in with a reel, you know, actors bring in a reel of previous work that they've done, other scenes they've played, other characters. One actor brought in a reel, he'd been in 6 movies, and Justin Lin said in every one of the movies he was delivering the pizza. I think there's a little in-joke in Better Luck Tomorrow that the only white characters in the movie are the ones usually played by minority groups, the clerk, the, you know, the person at the video store and so forth. That's shocking, but I think it's changing. You've worked a lot, Jaqueline, in movies. You've made a Star Trek movie. You were in Volcano. You started out in The Mighty Ducks. Broke Down Palace is a very good film. Yes, that's a great film. So you've kind of come up through this. Are casting directors becoming less rigid in their narrow categories?
I wish I could say yes, but I don't know that that's necessarily true. I think in television, their minds are opening up more toward Asian American women. And of course, you know, Hollywood, it's a business. And so it's like what you've been seen doing or what the famous person of the moment is seen doing is sort of what people will look for, like people to play, was particularly in film. And I've run into that. My agents were not so excited for me to do this project. As a matter of fact, they were trying to get me into a series. And when I decided that I didn't want to do that, we sort of parted ways. And I haven't really, they're really happy for me now that the film got nominated for two
Spirit Awards. Spirit
Awards,
yeah. And a Cassavetes Award, yeah.
Yeah, and it's done well, but I still have to ask filmmakers when I see them, like we went to so many festivals in the last year, and the benefit of that as an actor is that you get to talk to filmmakers one-on-one, just like another person, just with equanimity. And I just say, have you ever? And they go, and basically the answer is no, not yet. And the way that I made my way in the theater, I went to the Goodman School of Drama in Chicago. And started in Chicago. And the first major role that I got was from a woman who worked at the Wisdom Bridge Theater, and she cast me in a role to play a British social worker who was 32 years old in a play about pornography. And I was like 22, right out of acting school. And her husband was the artistic director of the Wisdom Bridge, and he had said to me, I've been wanting to work with you for a while, but I haven't found any good Asian plays yet. No, really. And a boyfriend that I had a couple of years back, he's a filmmaker, he also said the same thing. I really want to work with you, but I haven't found the Asian part yet. He said, I'm reading a story from The New Yorker about an Asian dentist. And here he was involved with me, and he was an Asian. But anyway, through that woman's help, which I'm sure, you know, when Sidney Poitier accepted the Academy Award, he said it. He said, I want to thank these 5 people. So through that woman helping me, her husband saw my work, and he gave me a title role in a Shakespeare play and then a Shaw play, and through that I was offered, you know, some wonderful, wonderful work. But it was about an individual wanting to take that chance.
Michael. Well, I was actually talking to you about this at, over dinner. And, well, since this movie was done about 2 years ago, so I guess legitimately I've been acting for 2 years now. And, well, I mean, you know, legitimately. So I have a manager and stuff. And this year, actually, from January to up to this point, I've had a lot of auditions. I mean, more than, 20 probably. Unfortunately, every audition required an accent. So I don't think it's getting any more bigger or better. It's just when you have individual guys who create parts for you, then it's, but being, specifically being Asian American, is something I don't really like to discuss, but since we're here.
I'm about to change the subject.
But you know, the truth is they only will look at you when they need you. So I've auditioned for the Tibetan monk and, the pizza boy. And there's a new movie coming out that required a Japanese pitcher, but unfortunately I'm too short. And you know, honestly, I'm about as Mark Twain-ish as you can get. You know, I'm cultured, but I'm very push the lawnmower with no motor and go fishing in the creek and stuff. And I can't really excel at that kind of role where I have to speak with an accent and stuff. So I don't think you'll be seeing me in those kinds of things.
There was that. Well, let's stop talking about Asian American. I am thinking though of that idiotic guy who got up after Better Luck Tomorrow at Sundance and told Justin Lin, "This is such a negative portrait of these characters. Don't you have a duty to your people to paint a more positive portrait?" And I got up and said that I thought that was incredibly condescending, that no one would ever say that to a white director. And but even more to the point, after that screening was over, the cast members, I found myself talking to them, and they were all practically in tears saying, "That son of a bitch wanted to take these great roles away from us and give them to white actors. They have no idea how hard it is for us to get a three-dimensional speaking feature-length lead role in a movie." And I hope it's changing. I think one of the things we've done at this film festival is try to show that there are all kinds of people who are all Americans, and we're all here, and we're all part of this culture, and that's it. And I'm encouraged sometimes that audiences will accept now films. There are now action films that don't need a white lead at all. You can have an Asian guy and a black guy, as long as they blow up a lot of stuff, you know. We just don't want to let them start talking or anything. But I mean, at least Hollywood doesn't feel, well, you know, you have to have, there's a formula in which you can have one minority group, but you can't have two minorities. And besides, what's a minority anyway? There aren't any majorities left in this country. So the hell with it.
And so forth.
I just want to say before we go to the audience, I love films that bring me into them rather than coming to me. There are some films where you just sit there and the entire film is served to you, like a drive-in curb service or something, and there's nothing that you have to do except be a receptor. As long as your eyes and ears are in working condition, that's all you need to be as a viewer. I love films like this that draw me in, that intrigue me, that have mystery, that and yet I never felt as if I was being toyed with. I mean, there's nothing withheld from the audience that isn't withheld within the movie by the characters for their own reasons. And there's nothing revealed that isn't revealed at the time that it would be naturally revealed by those characters for their own reasons. So despite the fact that information was withheld from me, it was all fair. And then I became intensely curious about motives, particularly your motives, your character's motives. But then, as the picture becomes more clear, I wonder what kind of buried tactic is going on here. Is there a feeling, in a way, that that your character has been that the basic thing that you're supposed to do eventually is to drive Michael into the arms of your sister, that was your sister's plan, or whether that's possible or not. Now, I didn't know. I still don't know at the end for sure. But all of these things, and I assume she was your sister.
Yeah.
I mean, that was, all of these things just made me so intensely curious and attentive and open to the film. I mean, I don't know what the, isn't that true?
It's funny. I think I heard like all these people in the audience turning to each other and say, sister? Okay, I get it now. It's like, that's what the murmur was there.
It's never said in a word.
No.
But it's absolutely clear to me anyway. But
yeah, certainly if you see it twice, because Roger's now seen it twice. You want to rate, who got it? Oh, okay, well, never mind then, okay. The balcony got it, all right.
Questions from the audience.
Hi.
That's true, too.
The surround, it wasn't so bad in the balcony, right?
Yeah, there's no speakers up there.
Awesome. I thought the movie was incredible. The acting was wonderful. And I love movies like this where you have to analyze it, pull it apart. In fact, I was sitting here with my fiance during the movie asking him questions, commenting, and he was telling me to shut up and watch the movie. But anyway, I guess I have one question directed towards Jaqueline and an observation directed towards the writer, Eric. My question, first of all, is when you were acting this film out, Jaqueline, what was your, analysis or interpretation of what your relationship was with your sister? And I guess my big question is, why? And with Eric, my question is, I've noticed that it seemed like, and maybe you can tell me whether I got this right or not, but Michael's character seemed to do a lot, just seemed to be reading a lot, and I found it kind of ironic that Jaqueline's character was a writer. And my question is whether he was trying to read Jaqueline's character simply because she wasn't really very forthcoming with who she was exactly. So I don't know, maybe you can clarify some of those things.
It's so simple. And it doesn't seem so simple, but really, Eric had said, these two young girls grew up together. One was just the perfect Asian princess, just beautiful and told it all the time. And in an Asian family, you know, it is a virtue, and I'm sure it is in many other families, but it's such a virtue to be the beautiful, perfect little girl. And Darcy was not that. She was great at sports. She wasn't the beauty in the family. She was more like a guy. And so she sort of, Eric had it in his mind, I won't tell you too much, but that Darcy had sort of tried to coach Laurie to become more like her, because Darcy had never really been accepted that way and therefore wasn't accepting that in herself. And she and Laurie just sort of split ways at a certain point. So Darcy's wandering through town and Laurie says, hey, I have two guys. I've got two. You want to come on a date with us? And Darcy's like, no, I'm not interested. But she finds her way to him on her own and wants to figure out what this is about and what this is that Laurie's doing. And that's basically it. I mean, is there jealousy? I bet. Does she intend to ruin things? I don't think so. I think she's just, Eric kept saying there are two people in you. There's Darcy and there's Charlotte. And Charlotte only comes out in very rare moments before Darcy will smother her. So that was what was going on.
And I would add to that that she's sort of she's surprised to find that in the worst imposter situation that she's ever probably put herself in. I mean, she always uses a bar name, but here she truly hasn't introduced herself to this man as an imposter. And yet, here she is with probably the one man she's ever met who she would like to reveal Charlotte to. And it's almost as soon as they've met, it's too late because she's introduced herself as an imposter. And so then for the rest of the movie, she's sort of in conflict whether it's worth the risk to let this Charlotte character come out. And I think that moment that you mentioned on the rooftop when she asks him to run away with her is Charlotte doing something that Darcy is like, what are you, you know? Not to say she's schizophrenic, but you know what I mean? Yeah. So, and then it's not that Michael prefers Laurie in that moment. He doesn't look at Laurie because he loves Laurie more. But that dichotomy or that competition that they always had, Charlotte's fear that this sort of well-trained Asian female model was the only model, and that by making other choices, she was dooming herself to a life of loneliness. Like that fear is so strong in her, and her sister represents that opposite choice and therefore makes her feel very insecure. So if it's even possible that this, I mean, not this man, but the character that he plays, who is in his own way sort of different from the way that men are trained to be, if he too would prefer to be with this little dippy cheerleader to a real woman, then she's lost. And she doesn't even want to stick around to find out if that's even possible. So she flees that rooftop. And then Charlotte makes her go back.
Go ahead.
Go ahead.
I just wanted to say one thing that it's a fascination for me, and I've written a film about it, actually. What happens when a young woman doesn't want to be what's expected of her? What's left? And can that draw people to who she really, really is? Can someone try to sort of stand in the negative space and be seen? And I think that that's what Darcy is about for Charlotte.
I want to try to be more articulate in my earlier statement, which I realized was completely confused. I'd like to observe that Laurie tells Darcy, please don't do two things. And then Darcy, I guess, does both of them. And at the end, Laurie is with Michael. Is this a case of please don't throw me in the briar patch, or?
I remember that little nursery rhyme, that little story, Brer Rabbit. No, I think that...
Laurie hasn't figured it out that way.
No, I think that's a pretty impossible task that she gives to her sister. She says keep it real, but she's complicit in this deception. And she says it's okay for her to be with Michael, but she doesn't want her to hurt him. And really, I mean, I think one of the more convincing lines in the movie is when Laurie says, I think I might marry him, you know, of Justin. And that's what she really believes. She really believes that Justin is the guy for her and that Michael is sort of, you know, just a friend. Someone who can provide that admiring gaze when Justin's eyes aren't open. I think, like you say, if this were a movie, she'd pull out a knife. I think if it's a movie, you make sense of everything all together as if some author had written it, and it makes sense that the whole thing was designed to bring together this kiss at the end. And one of the reasons why I cut before you actually see the kiss happen is that I don't want you to say, oh yeah, there's the kiss I was waiting for, that's good. I wanted you to sit there in black for a little bit and think, is that what I really wanted to see? That action that she takes, you know, with Justin to go on this road trip and to eventually sleep with him. I think in a movie would be, yes, okay, the director has decided that this is what's gonna happen, and so this catalyst character is the agent that brings that together. And of course, those are her motivations because she's not a person, she's an agent that brings things together. But I didn't have any particular ending in mind as I was writing it, and the characters, you know, became so true to me that I couldn't make them do anything that they wouldn't themselves do for my benefit or for the story's benefit to make it more, you know, accessible to the audience or make it more marketable to a producer. She did that because she was in pain, and probably the worst pain she'd been except for maybe that first time that Jaqueline sort of hinted at. And when you're in pain, sometimes you do things that you're ashamed of later. And I think she just wanted to like finally like extinguish that part of her that could still love, that Charlotte part of her that kept getting her into these situations where she could be hurt this deeply. And I mean, I don't know if I said this to Jaqueline, but in my mind, the deal was if Charlotte went back and failed, that was it. No more Charlotte. And Darcy was going to put an end to Charlotte. And so it's basically Darcy choosing Justin as the event that will extinguish her soul, the Charlotte part of her.
The thing I also like about Eric and his writing, and Eric as an artist, is that he always says, embrace the thing, he embraces in himself the things that are kind of repugnant to him. No, he does, and he said, most people sleep with people who they don't, they're not, their heart wouldn't be wrecked by. Because he was talking to me about how it can be sometimes even more erotic to sleep with someone who you feel less about, because then you can kind of fly, particularly for someone who's an introvert or someone, you know, it's sort of like, oh, you're not completely looking at me and you're not looking at me with the eyes that I think that I want looking at me. So I can just go for this. But it ends up backfiring on her. I mean, I think that she expresses the love to Justin, strangely, that she would love to express to Michael, which is trippy.
Isn't it interesting that this is all kind of the same sort of thing that Neil LaBute's Your Friends and Neighbors was about? And he also said that he refused to end the film. It just continues after it's over, the stories.
It's interesting that I was here watching, you know, that film and you know, it was weird to watch Shall We Dance and then watch this as well. Neil LaBute's film that you guys all saw, many of you saw, Your Friends and Neighbors, sort of pushed me back from the dark places I was thinking of going with this movie. And I think a lot of the impetus began with Five Easy Pieces, which is another
movie. You're saying you saw it when it first came out and it pushed you back a little.
Yeah.
Oh, that's...
Five Easy Pieces, which was directed by Bob Rafelson, who was also here with Blood and Wine. It's so weird that all these movies came together. And I've been so busy, I didn't even look at what was going to happen here. But it was so strange to actually meet Bob Rafelson. Because Five Easy Pieces was, if any film, the most like influential film on me as a director, at least for this story. And it was the characters.
I remember the ending of Five Easy Pieces.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. And there's a road trip, too. There's an unexpected road trip. And there's a lot of elements. You know, the Susan Anspach character is sort of a Darcy. There isn't really a Michael character. Well, I guess you could say the older brother is kind of a beta male. But anyway, the best comparison, I think, is that this guy's no beta male. I had never thought that a guy like this was going to play that character. But it just, when I saw him actually in a film that Justin Lin directed, a short, I never forgot it. And when I had such a hard time finding a way to balance this sort of emasculated man that he is with Laurie and the, you know, the very strong, quietly imposing man that he is with Darcy, with the many, many wonderful actors that came to auditions, I actually just called Michael and asked him to play the part because I thought he was the only person who could possibly do that. But Neil LaBute's film, it's funny, in another film, another kind of in this Asian American thing was by Philip Gotanda called Life Tastes Good. That pushed me back in another way, too. Like, I saw people actually exercising the artistic tenets that I was starting to form for myself for this film and said, well, maybe that's not as far as I want to go. And the characters that were so dark in Your Friends and Neighbors, so dark that I couldn't perceive where the darkness came from. They were so dark that I couldn't see through the glass bottle and see why they were dark. So I asked myself if every time a darker element came into the script as I was writing it, why it was there, and found something that wasn't necessarily dark beneath it.
I guess we've only had one question so far, right? Let's take another one.
Okay. I wanted to ask you, in writing it, if you're very influenced by fairy tales, because it seemed like such a classic fairy tale scenario, the two sisters who have very different qualities and have been treated unequally in their family. And usually it's the princess in the castle at the top of the hill, but in this case, the prince was in the castle. He had the door that was very hard to open, and he had the narrow stairway that you had to go up. Hey. And then the two sisters arrive at the castle, and it just seemed to me very much a modern fairy tale.
It is
that's,
now.
That's what?
It is now.
It is now, yeah. I do, that's fascinating, but I do refer to that house as a love palace. And I do, I call it Laurie's love palace. And I do sometimes refer to the relationship between, what, you want me not to say this?
No, I didn't know that.
I refer to like the relationship between Laurie and Michael as the princess and the eunuch. And not this Michael, the character. Because you know what you're talking about is, you know, okay, in the old days they used to castrate men to make it safe for them to go into the harem and guard the princess or whatever, right? And you know, to kind of reflect on what I was saying earlier, you have men, whether they're Asian, whatever, it's not necessarily a racial thing, but you have men in real life who are willing to sort of introduce themselves to a woman as just a friend, essentially castrating themselves in return for this delusive intimacy. And so there's a prince, there's a princess, and a eunuch in this little love palace. So you kind of, yeah, touched on something that's right.
Okay, another question. We have extra time because the next movie doesn't start till 9:30. So
I have a comment. I just wanted to say I thought the Michael character was very strong. I didn't see him as emasculated at all. Right. I really, really liked the way he portrayed a male. And he would be an interesting person to know in life. Thanks.
Thank you.
Yeah, like I said, I never imagined in writing it that the character would be played this way. It was that I'd actually, because as the story between Darcy and Michael grew, and it grew second because I met Jaqueline and then wrote the part for her, as that relationship grew, it became impossible for him to be the eunuch that I wrote for the first act before Jacqueline's character enters. And so when I was auditioning, I realized I'd made something impossible, you know, to fill, or it was almost impossible, but there happened to be one guy. And Michael in other ways also took the role in a different direction. And I think, you know, for you people who are gonna make movies soon, an important skill to have as a director is to be open to the alchemy of collaboration. And that's something that certainly did serve this film with all three of the people who are sitting here and many others.
Hi, I'm in the back on the right. You're right. I'm curious to know about your work with Michael Brook. I thought he did a great job on the music. And I'm wondering if he kind of nailed it on the first take or on the first effort, or whether there was a lot of collaboration between you, whether you worked together over a number of days in a studio together. Could you say a little bit more about that, please?
That's another great example of collaboration. What Michael did, and for those of you who don't know, Michael Brook is a world-renowned guitarist and producer. He plays guitar on all of Hans Zimmer's scores, and he also scored movies like Affliction, Getting to Know You, and Albino Alligator. And he's doing a new album now that includes music from Charlotte Sometimes. What Michael did was he saw the movie and then he wrote like 38 songs, all of which were inspired by the movie but not specifically for a scene, except for one. The song that plays when they're in the junkyard and Laurie jumps in the car with him, that he wrote for that scene. The rest, all he just wrote, you know. And what I did is I took those songs and put them into Final Cut Pro, the editing system that I had by this time on my laptop. And I just would lie in bed with the laptop on my stomach and these weird looking speakers that my girlfriend had bought me. You should see these speakers. So, but anyway.
Michael has seen the speakers, obviously.
Yeah, I don't want to say anything. But anyway, what I did is I had like 8 different versions of the movie, and I sort of built a system of songs and how it would go. And I began with Cody Chestnut, but you know, Michael's first song is very acoustic and very soft and sweet, And then as it starts to get darker, there's more of an electronic sound. And then Darcy's character enters, and there's another kind of sweet, really romantic sound. And then again, as it gets darker, you start to hear these warblings that almost sound like you dipped a microphone into hell, you know. And it was what I did is I edited his music in Final Cut Pro, and then made to the frame notes on what I had done to his music, and then gave it back to him. And then he started to formulate the actual finished cues based on my edits. So he took his Pro Tools mix and conformed it to my edits. And then we did collaborate quite a bit inside his home studio. You know, I have a little bit of a music background. Like all Asian boys, I played violin when I was little. And so, you know, we did work together a lot. And I would definitely, for those of you making films, I'd recommend that process.
About two more questions. Let's have one.
Hi, I'm right here in the middle. First, I just want to make a comment about the, in my opinion, it was a self-sacrifice of Charlotte or Darcy to sleep with Justin so that her sister could go to Michael. That's just my own opinion. I have two sisters that I love dearly, and not that we were ever that way, but I could so see them doing something like that, or me. Anyway, that's neither here nor there. That was just my opinion. Anyway,
someone else said a similar thing to me.
We've heard it a lot.
Well, sisterly love is a beautiful thing. Anyway, then there's two of us here who are wondering about the book that she gives to Michael. My question about that is, why don't you either reveal what the book is or something about what she writes? And his question is it her book that she wrote, her original book?
The reason is that if these were real people and the camera was just sort of, and this is the question I asked myself when I designed every scene, if the camera were just there and these were real people who weren't aware of it, how could I photograph the scene without them being aware there's a camera? And the kind of over-the-shoulder shots that you know you typically see in most movies, they give you a great view of Julia Roberts' eyes. In this movie, would have been obtrusive because you'd be like, well, there's a camera right in Michael's ear. How could she not know that, right? So a close-up that comes in to the book would not have fit within my stylistic regimen. And then in the post-production, like, I got a lot of people saying, you know what this film needs is voiceover. You know, every time something is unclear, you should have somebody's voice, either Michael's or Jacqueline's or both, come in and explain it, and then everything will work, you know? And actually, this was the guy who was supposed to be our publicist who said that. And then he left, and then the guy who ended up... This is the first time I ever showed it, you know, and then he left, and the guy who ended up being a savior for this film, John's partner, Chris Miller, who I called the Yoda of post-production, he waited till this guy was gone, and he looked at me, and he said, if you put voiceover in this movie, I'll kill you. The truth is, I didn't write a particular gift. I asked Jaqueline to choose a gift, and she never revealed to me what the book was. And the only
do you want to know what the book is, Eric?
Yeah, I'd love to know. I've never known.
It's not...
The book and the message will remain.
The message I won't say, but the book is good.
No.
Did you read it?
Half.
No! It's the thinnest book!
No, nobody knows.
He's a mechanic.
Well, he won't let me say, but it's a great...
I'll let you say, and that's my panel.
Darcy didn't write the book. The book is The Oblivion Seekers, and it's translated by Paul Bowles. It's by Isabel Eberhardt, who lived in North Africa as under the guise of a man and died in the 19-teens in a landslide. With papers and a typewriter found by her body. And these stories are about North Africa and one's right to be a vagrant. And they're written from a woman who was, for the most of her life, in a Muslim sect, as under the, in a very bad disguise as a man. So, Paul Bowles did the translation, but it's by Isabel Eberhardt, and it's called The Oblivion Seekers. And it's, I recommend it. It's an amazing collection of short stories.
There are a lot of answers that I don't actually know. And one of the ways we designed the performance is we had the actors work things out. For instance, the meaning I told him some things, but I told her some things, but not everything. The second to last line, only Michael and Eugenia have that knowledge.
Yeah. One more question.
Hello, hello, hello. Yes, one more statement. A little footnote to the business about racial discrimination and that sort of thing, which of course is a major problem. Now, it happens that it's not only sight, but also sound. I have been asked, because of my very strong Midwestern accent, what are you, and so forth. This is very unfair, you know. But think of speech. Speech is very, very important in getting you discriminated or at least put aside. And of course, there's the major problem that those things happen. Do you know why? Because there are too many Republicans and not enough Democrats.
Well,
I won't touch that, but I will say that in terms of accents, you can imagine how difficult it is for me as a filmmaker who wants to depict Asian Americans as being just as human and real as all Americans are, that most people's association with Asian faces is through an accented sort of caricature. You know, Michael's gone out for 20 auditions and all of them needed accents. That's why I think it's hard for this movie to land with some people because they're not accustomed to seeing Asian faces and seeing them as being just as human as real Americans are. They mostly think of Asians as immigrants or worse, as the axis of evil. So.
You know, I have some Asian friends who get totally pissed off because they'll say, well, what are you? Well, I'm Japanese American. Oh, do you speak Japanese? You know, as if it's genetically, you know, nobody's ever asked me if I speak German, you know. That is so stupid. And yet people ask these stupid, for example, after Better Luck Tomorrow, I walked out of the screening at the Park City Library and somebody said, how come her little brother didn't look like he was Asian? Remember?
Yeah.
How could that be? And I said, a miracle. I mean, I have no idea because
she's adopted.
She's obviously Asian and her little brother is obviously 100% Caucasian. How could that be?
It's clear in the movie that she's adopted, they say.
Of course, it talks about, have you ever got to look for your real parents? These are my real parents. But that line is way too subtle for somebody who would ask that kind of question, obviously.
Right, so they'd never get Charlotte sometimes, obviously.
But get over it, you know, just figure it out. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Well, no, I think at the end of the day, it's like if you want a good actor, hire a good actor, and you are excluding a lot of great actors. But when you hear, you know, we probably won't take your film because it's an all-Asian American cast, or we probably won't take your film because we don't know who the actors are, even though we recognize the film is great, and you hear that over and over again, you think that that will be the definitive answer. So,
yeah, we should all thank you because the day you wrote that review, it really changed the way that distributors looked at this movie. And I'm sure that May 2nd wouldn't be happening if it hadn't been for your support of the movie. So thank you.
But you see, it's because it's a good film. Because I went to see your film not knowing if it would be good or bad. Had it not been good, it would not have been invited and you could not thank me. So actually it begins over there on that side of the stage and comes this way, it really does. Thank you very much. Thanks for being
here.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.